And we're live. Hey, Skylar, welcome to the Truth Revival.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Yes, I'm so excited to chat with you. We have been friends for a very long time.
Yeah, a while.
I know. And I love how things come full circle and that you were put back into my life path over some time apart, but for an even greater reason, I feel like this time, and for much more purposeful and intentional reasons. So I'm so glad to have you back in the circle and to be a part of what we're growing and what we're doing.
Yes, I'm so excited too. When we started reconnecting, I was just like, oh my gosh, it's like everything comes back full circle.
I know. So tonight, friends, we are talking about entrepreneurship, and we're talking about the different ways that it can look and the different, you know, everyone is selling something essentially, right? We're selling visions for ourselves. We're selling what's for dinner for our kids. And so many of us, like myself, have an entrepreneurial spirit, but I never had a concept, or I never had this like to come up with a certain thing to go to market. So tonight we're going to talk about, this is a two-part series, everyone. Joshua will be on next week interviewing his sister, Amber Crockett, with Amber Blends, because again, another type of entrepreneurship product to the market. But tonight we're going to talk a little bit about direct sales, network marketing, MLM, whatever you want to call it. Because I think in the time that we're living in right now, everyone has to take into consideration diversifying their revenue streams. We're living in a time where no jobs are stable necessarily. The carpet can be pulled out from underneath you. You get caught in a situation where you can't pay for your lifestyle anymore, and you got to have a backup plan. And a backup plan is how I ended up in network marketing the first time. So, Skylar, you've been in the industry, what, 10 years now?
Almost, yep, 9 and a half.
That's amazing, first of all, that you have that amount of tenacity. And you've been really successful in three different companies, and we'll get to that later. But I really want to talk about why network marketing. Why did you choose the non-corporate path and dive in over here?
Well, I would like to kind of put it as like network marketing kind of chose me. I didn't choose this as my path. This kind of fell in my lap and I realized I was good at it. And I think that a lot of people fall into that sometimes. You know, no one wakes up one day and decides they want to be a network marketer. But I was in a situation where I was a young mom. I was pregnant with my second child and I was only 22. And I had no other choice at the time but to figure it out. And a lot of moms get in situations where they're like, I have to figure this out. I have to figure out how to feed my kids and feed my family. And for me, you know, being a young mom and having such a difficult pregnancy with both of my children, being stuck on bed rest was kind of like being stuck in quarantine. That's where I was at. I could not go to work. I could not make money. I was on leave from my job. I was substitute teaching and working at a restaurant. And I could not get out of bed. I was bedridden for 4 months. And during that time, I found network marketing, and I really didn't pick it up as a career path. I picked it up because I wanted the product and I wanted to use it after my pregnancy. And I really just didn't have any desire to make a ton of money with it. But once I started really getting into it, I saw the earning potential, and that was something that I just couldn't look away from.
Mm-hmm. And you had, and your mom had been in corporate America. Your dad is still working in corporate America some, yeah, right? So you come from a family that has experience in that, as do I. You know, I had a really successful stint in the same company where we met, and six-figure earner. Interestingly enough, technology is what took me out. And then I went to go work in corporate America serving the technology industry because it was life-changing. It was frustrating. It was, man, but I learned so much. You and I were talking before, and you know, what are some of the things that you would like for people to know about this industry? And one of them was the irreplaceable relationships. Talk about that.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, before I got started with this industry, I lived in a very small town, and it was difficult for me to get out of that small town mentality that I had. But I moved up to Indy when I met my husband, and I had no market. I had no friends. I had no circle. I didn't have people I could call in the middle of the night if something went wrong. I just didn't have that. I had to recreate myself here. And it gave me the opportunity to do that. But what came with that was some relationships that are irreplaceable. You know, most of my very best friends have done business with me, whether they're in it now or not. I still met them through network marketing. That's what it's all about. It's about building relationships with people. And I have the opportunity to do that more than the average person because I'm putting myself out there so much and I'm helping so many people. But it's really not just a blessing to them that I can mentor them. It's a blessing to me as well. It's something that will bless me from years to come, 4 years to come. You know, it's something that you can't put a dollar amount on that.
No. As some of the, like you said, some of my greatest friends right now, the best friends that I have came through that organization, including you.
Yeah.
And so I am forever grateful for these relationships, learning, growing together, figuring this out. We were like a family. We were and are today even like a family. Yeah. It is what taught me about drive, about selling, about relationships, about marketing. You know, it is what propelled me into some self-discovery and personal growth and development, achieving your highest self, which is interestingly enough, the motto of the current company that we are in. So, but I do want to, this is the truth, right? This is the truth revival. We talk about the truth in and out of subjects. And so I want to talk about the pros and cons. Because just like in corporate America, just like in owning your business, being an entrepreneur, you know, Joshua does hair, loves doing hair, has been doing it for years, very successful, but he's also an entrepreneur in like everything that he does. He creates beautiful people, beautiful spaces. So, but I know that he has had some struggles in, you know, owning a business and the responsibilities that come with it. So talk to me about some of the pros and cons that you've experienced in your business.
Well, I would say every pro probably has a little bit of a con, just if I'm being honest. My first one that I would probably recognize is, you know, you have the potential to make an endless amount of income with a business like this, especially if you find the right compensation plan. And I think that's very important to acknowledge. But working from home can also be difficult because you have to be very self-motivated. And that's not something that I just woke up one day and decided I was going to be motivated to work on my own every day. That's something that's come with time. That's something that's come from a lot of personal development. And, you know, I have to be very intentional with my schedule because now I'm on the opposite spectrum. I'm kind of a workaholic, so I have to know when to put it down. So from both angles, you have to be self-motivated to get up and work your schedule and stick to it so you're not just laying in bed in your pajamas all day. I try to get up every single morning and get myself ready as if I was going to a job. And there's some days where I just can't stand being in this house anymore and I'll go to Starbucks or Panera Bread or somewhere else to work because I just need to get out of the house. And I think a lot of people now understand that because a lot of people are working from home with COVID and everything going on. But, you know, on the opposite end, I can overdo it. And with my first business, I went way overboard. I was doing so much unnecessary work that wasn't income producing because I thought I had to. My entire life revolved around that job, so to speak. I missed out on a lot of memories and good times in my life and even hard times that I don't even remember living through because I always had my phone in my hand. So I think it's important that you have to have a healthy relationship with your business. I'm not married to my business. I used to brag about being married to my business. I am no longer married to my business. We're just dating. And I truly am thankful that I went through those hard times so that I could see how much life I was missing out on because I was so excited and so desperate to keep the flow of income coming in. So now I really think that I have it down to a science. I'm very strategic with my schedule. I'm very intentional with my agenda and the things that I have going on every day. I put my non-negotiables in first. That's God time. That's kid time. That's husband time. And those are the things that I focus my attention on before anyone else gets a piece of Skylar, they get a piece of me first. And so I think that's a pro and I think it's a con. The other pro and con I would say is the relationships, like we talked about before, they're amazing, but I get so invested in like emotionally invested in people, sometimes that's hard to turn off too, because not everyone's going to come in here and have the grit or the willpower to push through the difficult times. And you find people of all, you know, from every angle, all different kinds of people, and you'll find those people that will put the work in and will be coachable. But then sometimes you get people that aren't. And for a very long time, I would get so invested emotionally into these people that when they would choose to walk away from it or give up on their dreams, it would break my heart. And it would mentally just get me so far down that I didn't even know if I could get back up. That's something that also came along with time and self-development and knowing it's not my fault that they gave up on their dreams. It's not my responsibility to make sure they don't give up on their dreams. All I can do is inspire people. I can't motivate them. So I would say those are the two biggest pros and cons that I've dealt with. But the pros definitely outweigh the cons. You just have to learn to have a healthy relationship with the cons, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. And I think that those are such good nuggets, Skylar, to take away. I have, interestingly enough, you know, I have been out of the industry for well over 5 years and probably more like seven, if I really start counting about doing the business full time. But one of the things I get to give to network marketing is that I got to be at home with my twins and be in discovery of what was next. I got to be present with them, but I had a very scarce mindset. I love that Cassie just posted abundance and detachment, because that's what I didn't know back then. And so for today, in the place that I'm in, first of all, I never thought I would say yes to another one ever again in my life. And your family is because of the way that you came to me and the dripping and the meeting me where I am and knowing, look, yes, I have the capability of being a rock star in this company. And I want to run this business symbiotically with my corporate job. I love what I do. I truly found my niche in serving clients from a technology perspective, but I'm never going to shy away from there being the trifecta. You were the right time, the right product with the right people. Mm-hmm. And as I'm out in the world talking to people, because I'm also of the mindset that I'm a hub for resources. I care so much about other people achieving their highest self, living their best life, you know, fueling their own fire and getting to where they want to be. I of course have products that can help their physical body, that help with their mental state, all of that. But my point in saying that is I'm telling people about it, and even more people are saying, oh yeah, I'm dabbling in this one over here, and I'm doing this one over here, and I'm doing that. So when we used to have to fight the stigma about network marketing, I feel like society and the world's kind of opening up to that. What are your thoughts around that?
I think so too. It's crazy. I think this year is what did it for people, I guess last year and this year, because, you know, there's so many friends that I have that turn their nose up to my businesses that I've done in the past. But then when they were furloughed and they had to stay home, and some of these people were like doctors, people that depend on their income and know it's always going to be there, and they get furloughed and they start not getting paid, or they start getting unemployment, but it's not paying as much, or even unemployment starting to take money back from people. And that happened to Corey. Corey lost his job at the beginning of the year last year, and they're making him pay back all the unemployment they gave him. And I think it put it into perspective for people, like, okay, I'm open to listening about an opportunity that can be my plan B, because nothing's guaranteed anywhere. It's not guaranteed in network marketing. It's not guaranteed in corporate America. But people are more open to hearing about it. And I was actually researching something today. All over TikTok, people are talking about micro influencers. And I had no idea what that meant. I just thought it was like another word that people were using, like a, you know, a hot word that people were using to get people to be brand reps and influencers for their businesses. And I started really looking into it. And they call them micro influencers because people are so sick of seeing these influencers with their perfect faces and their perfect hair and their, you know, Louis Vuitton bags that were bought by somebody else to advertise. Like, people want to see real. People want to see the small people, so to speak, the people that have never, ever gotten any kind of clout or attention. They want to see the real. They want to see the average people, the masses of people, not the big name people. And so they're called micro influencers because they might not have experience. They might not have a huge following. They may have a very small following, but because they're a real person, they're easily marketable. And it just kind of put into perspective that 2021 is the year for the masses. 2021 is the year for the people that have never thought they could be good at this to do something like this and make an income and have a plan B so they don't ever have to go to sleep at night worrying if a global pandemic's gonna hit and take away their job. Like that's important to me. And like I said earlier, you know, being on bed rest years ago did enough in my head that I never wanted to ever have to depend on me going somewhere to make money. I never wanted to have to depend on someone else to tell me what to do, or I have to be here at a certain time to feed my kids. And, you know, being in quarantine then and being in quarantine now, I'm seeing it happen to so many people and they're like, I never want to be in this situation again. And it makes me so much more passionate about my job and what I do because people finally are getting it. And it's okay that they're just now getting it. I'm happy that they're just now getting it. It opens up a whole new world for me to be able to help more people. And that's what I'm passionate about. That's what, you know, fires me up and puts that fire in my belly when I wake up in the morning. So I'm just like, I know that this past year has been so hard and so difficult, but for me, I see a very bright future for this world ahead of us because people are waking up.
That is so true. And I love that you called it your job, because so many people call it a hobby or, like I mentioned, dabbling in it or doing it. And oftentimes people get discouraged in this business because it is hard. Like people act like you can sign up and you magically have people show up in your network that want to do this. And you and I both know, no, it's the drip. It's the conversations. It's the planting of the seeds, which is no different than what I'm doing in my day job.
Right.
So what do you think has been what has made your success and your team's success? Because that's really what it's about.
I think that people will buy you before they ever buy a product. And I also think that people will be loyal to the people who are loyal to them. And even if somebody has quit a business with me in the past, I keep that relationship going. And that's not for my benefit. It's truly just because I don't know how to let go of people.
Are you a people collector like me?
Yes. It is a little bit of a personality flaw, but I have a really hard time just cutting people off. It's a good thing and a bad thing in certain circumstances, but I truly believe it's because people are so loyal to me because they trust me and because I've given them reason to trust me. I've given them reason to know that I have their best interest at heart and I'm genuine about it. And, you know, even in the past with other, you know, other companies, like I've seen people who are not loyal to their company because they've given them no reason to be loyal. They haven't invested in the relationships. They don't know the CEOs. They don't have, hey, don't come in here. No. Sorry. They don't have a relationship. So of course, when it's time to go, everyone jumps ship because there's nothing there holding it together. Mm-hmm. But when they see somebody that they trust and they're moving on to something different, they're like, I know they're going to kill it. And I want them to take me with them. And I trust them and I love them. And I care about them as a person. I care about what they have to say. I value their opinion. I know they believe in my dreams, and I truly think that's why I've been successful. It isn't because I just woke up one morning and created a huge following overnight. It's been blood, sweat, and tears all the way through, but it's been so rewarding. And you're talking about like how I called it my job. I just recently started stepping into that because I was so self-conscious for so long about what people thought I was doing. I was afraid to call it a job. I was afraid to recognize this as my career and own it. I was afraid to just be like, I'm a boss. Like I am a boss. I am the boss of this home. I'm the boss of this company. Like in this house, this is my job. And this past year, I don't know what it was, but you know, I decided after being knocked off my leadership pedestal for 2 years and just taking a back seat to everything else going on, I decided, you know what? I'm owning this. I was chosen for this. Like God chose me for this. This company chose me for this. I have to own it and I have to be confident and walk in that. And other people see that. And so it was really cool that you just mentioned that because I didn't even realize that I was calling it a job necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of like I'm finally finding that confidence in myself after 9 years. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? It's just crazy to me.
Yeah, unapologetically. I think that's the part that for 2020, look, I unapologetically want to do the things that I'm doing. I want to work a corporate job. I want to be a part of this company. I want to go to seminary. I want to empower other women to be who they want to be and live the life that they want to be, and men. But I'm just going to do the things, and you can join me on the venture and we will help each other get to where we're going. And it's okay if you don't. It really is okay. The thing I love about the leadership that we have in place today is the investment back into our teams. The people that we're bringing in, you know, I know what their dreams are. I know what they want to accomplish, and I'm going to partner with them. I'm not going to do the work for them. You know, where you mentioned it before, we were doing so much of the work.
Oh, yeah.
We were not in a place to realize, like, this is their business, not our business. We can lead them to the trough, but we can't make them drink. And I know this time around, investing in them and helping them be successful, ultimately, that means I will be too. And so I'm not worried about where I'm going. Of course, I have an intention around that. Of course, I see the vision. And I want to help them achieve whatever it is that they're wanting to achieve.
Right.
So Joshua says, we spend the majority of our young adult lives trying to fit in, and then the rest of our lives trying to stand out. Self-empowerment is key to standing in your greatness and being a quote-unquote rock star. Yes, we see what you did there. So, yeah, I think that I love, because we've watched each other grow. We have watched each other mature into these businesses. And we've both been knocked off,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
You know, and so what this time around, Skylar, what gets to be different?
I think that since I do have so much more confidence in what I do, and knowing that this is my big girl job, you know, I always felt like people looked down on me because I quit college and they all had these big girl jobs. This is my big girl job. People respect me because I've stuck with it. People respect me because they know I take this very seriously. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. It just feels different. I guess it's because, like, the trifecta thing you were talking about, like, everything, I'm aligned with everything that's going on in my business right now. I am aligned spiritually. I'm aligned mentally. My heart is 100% invested in it, but not in an unhealthy way. Mm-hmm. I've got an amazing group of people that are, you know, starving for success. I just feel like it's all coming together. And I think that everything leading up to this point prepared me for this. And that's something that I can't look away from. Like, everything that brought me here prepared me for this. I mean, I've been through some heavy life stuff. I had to have a hysterectomy last year, and that was like a very, very traumatic thing I did not want to have to do. And I literally woke up from that surgery feeling like God changed something inside of me. I wasn't, after it was over, I was at peace with it. And that's something that tied up a lot of my mental space for so long, because I was living in pain. And so being able to, like, separate myself from those bad parts of my life and looking back on them, I'm like, this was all God preparing me to do this job I'm doing now. And there's big shoes to fill being, you know, one, like, the first one in a company. That's a large responsibility, and it's, mm-hmm. it can be a heavy burden if you look at it that way, but I don't look at it that way. I look at it as I was made for this. I was created mm-hmm. for this time. And if I would have just been thrown into this role 9 years ago, I wouldn't have been molded and shaped to be able to handle it. So mm-hmm. everything's different this time. Everything is aligned with what I need and what I want. And mm-hmm. it's just a beautiful picture when I look at it. Like, it's just beautiful to me how it's all just came together and it's led me here.
Mm-hmm. I love that you talk about alignment. That's 100% why I said yes to this business, because it aligns with who I am, where I'm headed, and what I want to be doing in my life. That's truly, I love your family. And that is the reason why it was a hell yes. Not because it has been no, 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 no to all the other ones. And I'll tell you in full transparency, Skylar, like, I have moments of unworthiness pop up in this, because I was asked to be, you know, part of the top leadership. And I felt like I'm not up there. You know, I haven't ranked, I haven't done all these things because I'm a high achieving woman who wants to do things overnight. And there are moments of that I feel less than or I feel unworthy, and that's my stuff. So no one, you know, but this is the truth. And so we tell the truth on this show. And what I love about all of you is that you're encouraging and you don't go that, well, one of these days, or if you get busy doing your business, or if this was your main focus, it's, we believe in you. We trust you. We know that you're going to do what's right for this company and you're going to lead us in the right direction. And it doesn't matter when you get there because you will.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I love that.
And that's like when I was sitting and thinking and racking my brain, like, who can be at the top of this with me and help me run this show? Like, immediately I thought of you, because when I look at you, before I stepped into this role, I didn't see myself as having this big girl job. But when I look at you, I'm like, dude, she is like a boss, like a real boss. Like, she's out there in the corporate America being a boss. And it just, I know the potential that you have to do network marketing, but I also know the leadership abilities that you have and the ability to breathe life into people and to inspire people and to push people. And that's exactly what we wanted. You know, it's not about, you know, who can get there faster. It's about, what do we want the culture to be like? What do we want the foundation to look like? And it's been so amazing that we've got to handpick that. And we're still handpicking that. Everybody that's coming into this with us, you're chosen for this. And that's an awesome feeling.
Yeah. And that's what I love, that because I was talking to a young lady earlier today about it. And I went through my network of people, which is enormous now because I have been in corporate America and I've built these relationships. And a lot of them, Sky, like, I'm never going to be able to work with them, but I know them. I have had conversations. I know what they're looking for in their life, but I handpicked, went through and listed out my dream team, mm-hmm. the people that I would follow to the ends of the earth, the people that I would want to do business with. Mm-hmm. And I just went and made the ask. Like Cassie said earlier, I'm an abundant woman and there was zero detachment around their decision to join or not to join. But man, am I thankful for the ones that said yes. And I'm even more thankful for the ones that said no, because right out of the gate, you're not having to beg anybody to do this with you. You're not having to pull anybody along. We are in this together, but I will meet you where you're at and partner to get to where you're going. I'm just not going to do it for you, which before was exhausting.
Yeah, exactly. We were like, everyone, come on, come all.
Yes. So I wanted to run through some statistics because I'm floored. Like, I just had no idea that I knew that a lot of people did it, but the industry made $35.4 billion in 2018 in the US alone.
That's nuts.
That is so crazy. 6.2 million people in the US sold products and recruited new distributors in 2018. That's a lot of damn people.
Yeah.
And I feel like once these numbers are updated for 19 and 20, they're going to be even higher, because for all the reasons that we talked about previously, people are starting to wake up and freedom matters, and living a peaceful life matters. And network marketing is one of those ways of entrepreneurship that you can have that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's just crazy. I bet the numbers are double this year.
Probably. I'll have to keep digging or keep watching to see if they come out so we can update our viewers. But yes, so that 30 minutes went by super fast. I'm really sad because I love spending time with you. However, if there were a message to send to our entrepreneurs that are watching and listening, what would you tell them?
I would probably say that nobody comes into this with the confidence I have now. And it can be a scary decision. The fear of failure holds so many people, so many different people in place, and it kind of leaves you stuck in neutral. But my fear is bigger when it comes to me not doing something that's scary, because I don't want to live a life of regret, and I don't want to live a life that's the same all the time. I want to constantly develop and grow. And so my biggest thing I would say to you guys is, do it scared. Like, just do it scared. It isn't something to be scared of. But don't let fear hold you in a place that isn't serving your family anymore. Don't let fear hold you in a place that you're not getting fulfilled, or that you're constantly, you know, staying awake at night because you don't know if you're going to be able to go to work tomorrow. Like, do it scared. You mm-hmm. really don't have anything to lose. And that goes for anything that you're thinking about doing, any form of a business. You know, mm-hmm. it's not something that I was like, I can't wait to grow up and be a network marketer. Like, I never thought that. I never thought this would be rewarding. I never thought this would be my big girl job. And I never thought that it would supply my whole family and allow me to bless people the way it has. But I did it scared. I didn't think I would be good at this. Mm-hmm. And I became good at it. So if I can do it, knowing where I came from and what I've been through, and being the girl that no one wanted to hire because she quit every damn job she ever had, anyone can do something like this.
Yeah, I love that. Skylar, you are a boss.
Thank you.
I am a boss, and you all can be a boss too.
Yeah,
regardless of what you're doing, get out there. I love that. Do it scared. I have never heard that before. You should put that on a t-shirt. You should, with our beautiful Ariel, and then do it scared on the back, because that's amazing. You are an inspiration. You're a powerhouse. I'm so grateful for you, your friendship, your leadership, and to be on this journey with you full circle, back in the place where we belong, not sidelines, but as teammates. And yeah. So thank you for being on the Truth Revival tonight. You are amazing.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much for having me.
Yes. See you all next week. As I said, the Truth Revival will have Amber Crockett with Amber Blends, the essential oils, and Joshua James. So have an awesome week, and we'll see you in two.
Bye. Bye.